Well, I'm Senator Steve O'Bannon, and I have two great entrepreneurs with me. We're going to talk about the recent B&O tax increases that the legislature levied on a number of different sectors, but also in the building sector. Don, why don't you introduce yourself?
My name is Don Malott. I'm a managing principal at BCRA, and we're an architecture and engineering firm here in Tacoma and in Seattle.
How many employees do you have?
We have about 90 employees between our two offices.
Okay. And Michael?
I'm Michael Fass with MRF Construction. I'm a home builder here in Tacoma, Washington. And we've been here for 30-some-odd years.
Thanks for joining us. How many employees do you have?
We have about 7 employees.
All right. So as you gentlemen know, the legislature, I certainly didn't support this, but the legislature decided to increase the business and occupation tax on a number of sectors, medical, architectural engineering, home building. And we want to talk about its impact on your businesses. So maybe we'll start with you, Don. Talk to us a little bit about the impact of this B&O tax.
Sure. B&O tax is on gross receipts. And so for us as a company, that's a big deal, and regardless of what our profits are, we have to pay that tax, and it's not as impacting when times are good, but whenever our profits dip due to recession or those kinds of things, we still have to pay that tax, and it's a pretty big deal. I figured that the increase that we're looking at here is about $600. Per employee per year, and wow. that's competing for the benefits that we provide our employees, 401k matches, health insurance, those kinds of things. I mean, that's competing directly for those kinds of things. So it's a big impact to us.
So my calculation is it's about a 20% increase for most of the sectors that are impacted by this tax. Is that what your accountants tell you?
Right. I looked at our income statement for the first half of the year, and state taxes were the fourth biggest expense for us. So first was rent, then health insurance, then our 401k match. And B&O tax was fourth before the increase. So after the increase, it'll be number three. So it will be above our 401k match.
You calculate it to be about $600 per employee. So what does that mean in terms of what you were hoping to do, but now maybe you're having to have second thoughts about doing because of this increase?
Well, one of the things that we've done coming out of the recession is we've really tried to improve our 401k match for our employees. Mm-hmm. And we've seen great benefits from that. As we've increased that match, the employees have increased their contributions significantly. And so as we think about that, now we've got a direct competitor for those funds, and it just makes us hesitate to think about doing that again next year. I mean, that's just one example, but it's competing for the same dollars.
Michael, how about you? What would you say has been the impact of this 20% increase in your business?
The biggest thing that we're going to see is its impact on affordable housing. I'm the end producer of all these fees that get tacked onto all the professionals that we use to prepare building a house. And we keep saying that we want to have affordable housing. We have an affordable housing crisis in Washington State. And then we go and tack on more fees and more expenses to it to make us less competitive. So you say one thing, but you do another. And we're having to pass it on. And we're already getting pushback from homeowners about what they can afford with the cost of lumber. We've had our lumber prices have gone up tremendously due to lumber tariffs from Canada. So all those impacts are affecting what people have to spend. And if they don't have the money, they just don't do the project. That's what I'm afraid is going to happen. We're not going to put more housing into the process.
So you alluded to something there, that this B&O tax increase didn't just affect architects, but it affected a number of different professional groups that my guess is both of you gentlemen, your businesses rely upon.
You took an example, it's a 20% increase. That's on every single one of my trades that we use up front, very early in the process. And that's money that's allocated very early in the home building process. So you have to carry interest on that money as well during a project. So it compounds itself. So it's not only the amount we have to pay out, but then we got to carry it and pay it. And all that does is just decreases the amount of affordable, how a house can get priced. Because we have an absolute ceiling on how much a house can be sold for. But if we can't produce it for that, then we're going to have to go somewhere else.
So there's the perception you hear, well, can't you just pass it on to your customers? Any increases like this, you just pass it on. So it's not really going to affect your bottom line. Talk to me about that.
For us, we have contracts that are multi-year contracts. And so those prices are fixed. And so we'll take that hit initially. Over time, we may be able to pass some of that on, but some of our contracts are based on a percent of construction costs, so we're not able to actually increase those.
So there's your explanation for employees. You're going to have to probably pay your employees less or not invest in their 401ks, at least in the short to midterm, because of those fixed contracts.
Right, right, exactly. You know, I might add, because the B&O is on gross receipts, when we hire a sub-consultant, or if we have a sub-consultant that also has a sub-consultant.
Give me an example of a sub-consultant.
So for instance, if we hire a geotechnical engineer as a sub-consultant for a project that we're doing, they will also have to pay the B&O tax on their services. And then if they hire a driller to do the explorations out on site, that driller will also have to charge the B&O. So it will actually get charged three different times. Okay. And so instead of being a 0.3% increase, it's becoming a full percentage point,
right,
at that point by
and,
the time you multiply it up.
And those subs, they have accountants and they have lawyers, they have other professionals who are also going to have to pay 20% more B&O tax.
Right.
We'll pass it on to them. So you have this amplifying effect, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
It
correct.
Goes one step further. We charge sales tax on the final product that we produce.
Mm-hmm.
So the sales tax is on the overall amount that's built. So then you take that B&O tax and then you multiply it and you charge sales tax on it again. So you're double taxing it later on.
Okay. So these are just discussions, I can assure you, that don't happen in Olympia when taxes are talked about. The amplifying effect, the unintended consequences of a tax increase. One of the things you were telling me, Michael, was that if you can't build as many houses, then you can't sell them and generate sales tax.
Correct.
So the upshot may be that you'll not be able to build as many houses, and so we'll see less sales tax, maybe a little more B&O tax, but less sales tax. Talk about
right.
that.
The B&O tax compared to the amount of sales tax revenue generated by home building is a tremendous difference in the amount of dollars that the state actually sees and the local municipalities. The sales tax is a really large amount, and the reason that Olympia is seeing such a big increase in revenues is because we're building a lot of houses right now. So that sales tax hit bump that you're seeing is because that's what we're doing. And it's multiple levels. It's not just during the construction phase. It's not just on wages. It's also on the people that move into those houses and they live there. They buy products in their local communities, right, and generates additional sales tax. So it is a huge amount of revenue on the sales tax side. But if you get short-sighted and you stifle it up front, then you don't get the big benefit of the sales tax. And the end result is you'll end up with less net revenue as a result of something that was a good idea.
Yeah, and that's the other law of unintended consequences. People have to make rational decisions based upon these increased costs in their businesses, like an increase in B&O tax. And in doing that, you often see that you don't get the revenue that you project. I was talking to someone, we'll talk about the REIT tax, different tax now, but I was talking with someone who was saying, already we're seeing an adjustment in that because of that tax increase. We've had a really great economy here in Washington State. In fact, we have, I think, one of the hottest economies, if not the hottest economy. But we all know that's not going to last forever. So we're even hearing now about projections of a recession in the next 2 years. Whether it's 2 years, 3 years, or 1 year, we don't know, but we'll see something like that, some downturn. Talk to me about how I can tell you that, unfortunately, the B&O tax doesn't go down during a recession or a downturn. The legislature didn't write it that way. So what impact will this have on your business, assuming a slowdown in the economy?
Well, the fact that you're still going to charge the tax, what will happen is the individuals that are charging that, being billed that, just won't have work. So you won't generate the B&O tax because they won't have the work. They'll have to lay off employees or lay off workers because their volume isn't there when in a downturn. That's typical in the cycle. You know, you hire up during when it's busy, and then you've got a downturn. You have to let people go. And if they're not being billed, if they're not generating revenue, there is no B&O tax to be taken. So you get a drop off in sales tax and a drop off in B&O tax.
I mean, it's the case, right? You now you have this downturn. You've got to figure out how to cut your costs. You can't cut your B&O tax because the Department of Revenue won't let you do that. So you're looking for other ways to cut those expenses.
Right.
And jobs, unfortunately, right. One of those, right?
Right. And you know, and we're in a situation now where we really have an opportunity to get good people, and we have to be competitive with other states and other areas. They're not just local anymore. Now we're having to compete with Oregon and Idaho and other states. The millennials can go anywhere. So we have to be at a competitive wage package. And if we're paying that in B&O and not in wages and not in 401k, we're at a competitive disadvantage to attract people.
Oh, that's a good point.
Right, yeah, and I would say we probably would not hire some person that we would likely want to hire. Some new college graduate, we just wouldn't hire that position because of the expense.
When you're hiring someone, it's the cost of that, obviously that person's salary, it's the cost of health insurance, it's the cost of payroll taxes, it's the cost of an office or a chair to put them in. There's a real cost to hiring someone. And if we've, as a state, have put a barrier like an increased B&O tax on that, then you have to make that full assessment before you commit yourself to those.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Right. When we hire an employee, we figure that it takes at least 6 months before we begin to see a real return on that. So there's a risk proposition that we consider with every new employee that we hire. And I'm not even talking about how long it takes to actually receive money from our clients. I'm just talking about until you begin to receive a benefit as a
right.
company. And so when you have that risk and then you're facing a downturn, the decision you'd make is just, hey, let's hold off. Let's not hire
right.
at this point.
And unlike expenses of an employee that you can write off on an income tax, right? So you can offset that first 6 months somewhat by writing off the expenses of that employee. You don't get to do that with a B&O tax,
no,
right?
Straight off the top. And whether you're profitable or not, it doesn't matter. If your company's
right.
losing money,
yeah.
you still have to pay the B&O tax.
Well, there's an interesting thing that I've tried to understand about the B&O tax. With the sales tax, you're able to itemize the sales tax right on your receipt or your invoice. And so the client or the customer gets to see exactly what they're paying. With the B&O tax, we're not allowed to do that. And so it has to be buried in our overhead, which I've just found to be a very interesting thing that we're not able to itemize that. Whereas with the sales tax, that's very, very clearly itemized. You can see it right at the bottom of the invoice. Mm-hmm. It's an interesting...
You're saying from a disclosure standpoint, it's not that you can pass on that tax to the customer.
It's very, very hidden.
Yeah.
Our clients don't know it exists unless we tell them about it.
Yeah.
But it's a very real cost to us. I think for us, it's very clear. This impacts middle-class people. Predominantly in our company, this is going to hit people who are making $100,000 a year or less.
I mean, you're employing people all the way from architects and engineers, you know, down to in terms of the pay scale, down to receptionists and
correct
janitors
right.
and so forth. So right. they're all impacted. How about you?
People always ask me, why does it cost so much to do that? And then I tell them all these other things get added on. We are in the city of Tacoma. The city of Tacoma has a B&O tax. And it's a conversation we've had with the city for a long time. It's like, well, you're competitively disadvantaged because the cities next to you don't. So kind of an ongoing
yeah.
thing for us to be
right.
in Tacoma. We have to pay another B&O tax
yeah.
on gross
yeah.
receipts.
So
we pay that for having our business located
right.
here.
And we know of other businesses who have located outside of the city for that very reason.
Well, that's a good point. We think of these taxes in their isolation, but when you're looking at the total tax burden, this additional 20% could be the thing that for some businesses that say, I just can't afford to stay in Tacoma
right.
with the B&O tax I'm paying them, and now this increased tax, maybe I would.
Or I can't afford to stay in Washington. I mean, what the reality
right.
is if you it could be another state that doesn't have that. We've seen that with larger companies like Boeing that have gotten a better deal from another state
right.
to go relocate. With what we do, we can't really move to another state. So we're stuck here as the unintended benefactor of this tax because we can't move. We can't just pick up all
yeah.
of our works here, our reputation, and all the years have been built in Washington State. So we're having to live with whatever comes down the pike. But that's the problem with small business getting the bite of it. If we were a large company, a multi You know, a national builder, they could just move their operations to a different place and have no impact on it. Where we're stuck, the smaller companies are the ones that are really having to take the brunt of this and have no choice whether to do it or not.
Well, we have been thinking about our long-term plans as a company, and thinking outside the state is a very real possibility. And when we think about tax structure and we think about cost of living, it's a very real component of the discussion. And it really accelerates our thinking about work outside the state.
What I hear from a lot of my constituents and other business folks is it's beginning to feel like this B&O tax increase and other tax increases from this last session is a sign of more taxes to come. It's a sign of a culture in Olympia that is always searching for more revenue and not taking into account its cost on the economy. And so if that's the mindset, I hope it's not. We'll certainly keep challenging our colleagues to be thinking about the impact of tax policy and regulatory policy on small, medium-sized, and large businesses. But if that argument doesn't carry the day, what I'm hearing from a lot of folks is they're worried that we'll see more and more tax increases and more regulations. And so maybe it's time to begin to make that change now, not wait for 2 or 3 years when it will become financially even more difficult to make that change. Does that enter into your thinking as well?
It would be easier to plan for it during good times than in crisis mode when you're having to like slash and cut and where is it all coming from? But it doesn't seem to be the case in Olympia. They don't seem to want to do it that way. They say, we've got to increase revenue. Let's add on more fees because they can afford it now because things are going well. And you're shooting the messenger because the reason you're making it so expensive that all of a sudden you're self-fulfilling your prophecy of making it slow down because you've made it so expensive.
Well, if we're in a recession, it's pretty tough to make that argument, right? So it's better to do it now when times are good. So that's why we're seeing, I think, a lot of these tax increases. Even though we don't need them, even though we have these record revenues, we don't need them. Without thinking about when that slowdown comes, that these tax increases, their proportional burden will only increase them on businesses and will make it even more difficult for them to pull out of a recession or a slowdown and start hiring again because they will be using all their additional revenues just to pay that by definition got down to pay that tax burden. Any other thoughts before we conclude here?
The middle class folks are the ones who ultimately end up carrying this. Whether it's a person who buys a home and it gets more and more expensive here in Washington to buy a home, or as an employee, I think it's the middle class people who are really feeling the burden of this. And I just think that's a shame because those are the folks who are doing the good things in our economy.
No, I think that's a really good point. Well, thank you, Michael Dunn, for talking to me today to sort of give that true impact of tax policy on small and medium-sized businesses. I think we need to hear that, and I appreciate your time.
All right. Thanks.
Thanks.